Obviously, the main function of a secure browser is to be able to control the browser security. And within Prisma Access Browser, that's done within the browser security tab underneath the policy rules. And the first configuration, so when it's first fired up, there is a baseline rule, as we can see here, that contains the best practice configurations by Palo Alto, so it's added to begin with. There's only a certain amount of things that can be configured within there, and if we hover over the top, as we can see, we now get to see the fly out, I suppose it's called, that gives us an idea. Well, it doesn't give you an idea, it gives us exactly what is configured in there, and we can see it without clicking into the rule. Again, we have our change priorities. So we can change the priorities of the rules, we can move rules up and down. I don't know why you'd necessarily want to do that in this particular instance, but you could do that. We save the changes, or we can cancel. We can add a rule. If we add a rule, we have to remember that any rule that's added will go in at the top, and thus will be the main rule. So if we added one here, so our test rule, and all that, and history, set. Okay, so we're going to save that rule. It's going to complain to us that there's a broad rule warning. Not necessarily complain, it's going to inform us that we can edit the scope, so we can click on that to edit the scope of this if we want to. Or we can just continue on and save it, save anyway. And then when we save it, it's going to put it at the top. So we could change priorities there. And then we could pull that down to the bottom. As in this case, it is an open rule. It's not an open rule, but it's a rule that covers everybody. If, however, what we wanted to do, hover over it, delete the rule, delete the rule. If we wanted to add the same thing again, but we wanted to put it in, we knew where we wanted to put it, we can just hover over here. Can add a rule in priority there, put our test rule in and do something. We'll do that again, so enable, and we'll go for browsing history on browser close. Set, save that. Yes, we know it's going to be that, and now it puts the rule in where we want it put. So you've got those options when adding rules, which kind of makes it easier if you understand the rule base, and as the rule base more develops, you can put the rules in where you want to. Okay, so what we're going to concern ourselves with is the browser lock in this particular instance. So I'm going to just delete that to get rid of that. Okay, then we're going to bring up the Prisma Access Browser. Okay, and we see that on first bringing it up, because I've got two profiles saved. I've got mine and I've got the user one profile. We're going to click on the user one profile, and then it's going to ask us for our PIN code, which we put in, super secret PIN. And then that's opened our browser. Now the timeouts for this are set within the security policy, the browser policy, as we'll see in a minute, and they're tied to inactivity on the PC in the case of a PC or a laptop. So any inactivity timer that's on there, if you don't do anything at all, it will lock after that period of time. It's not just inactivity in the browser. So if the browser is open and you are doing something else somewhere else, like with, I don't know, text files or whatever, or moving files around, that won't start incrementing or decrementing, sorry, your browser timer. Okay, so that's tied to that. In the case of a mobile device, it's tied to the screen lock. Okay, so let's have a look and see. So if we just go over here, we can see it's got it enabled and it's 2 minute idle. If we go in to have a look here, we can see that it's configured under, so the scope, and it's from this user one policy particularly, and then we configure it in browser lock. We see the MITRE account use policies, and we see a link to that as well. And then we can have lock when idle for 2 minutes, 12 hours, 6 hours. I'm not sure you want to go that far, to be fair. And then we need an authentication method. So we need authentication method can be configured in the browser security. So let's do that now and we'll see that. So we're going to set that. One of the easiest ways to get there is to type it in here. So we've got an authentication factor there. So we click into there, and then this is where we can set our PIN code. So we have a PIN length of 4 in this particular instance, and then maximum failed attempts, and we can set the failed attempts, or we can go with a pass key. So an internal factor, and it So it tells you there, Windows Hello or Mac OS Keychain, or external factors like YubiKey, smart card, or mobile phone. So you can use external factors as well, and then you would configure that afterwards. But we're going to go for PIN code, nice and simple. And we set that, and those are the two things that need to be set together. We save that, and then that's our policy built. Of course, there could be an instance where you might need to remove that. And again, if we just click on our rule, so we come to our edit there, so we can see we've got mode active and disabled. For some rules, there's active, disabled, and monitor. Majority of monitor ones are going to be within your traffic rule. So you can put a rule in and you can just monitor it to see what the logs are coming off of it, which means that then that gives you the opportunity to test out a policy basically before you apply it. So here we can either set that to disabled, and then that will be the rule disabled, or again we can do it from here. So if we do it from here, we can set to disabled from here, and then once that rule is disabled, we'll give it a minute to come back to the browser, which is here. In fact, let's have a look. And we can reload it there. So if we now click out of that, then I open it back up. When I click on user one, you can see we no longer have the PIN code, and we can just go straight into our browser. That also means it won't automatically lock. So if I just come out of that again, if I come back here and just re-enable this rule, okay, we're going to set it to active. Again, we could have done that from inside the rule as well. We'll go back to our browser. Come back to our browser. Now we have our prompt for our PIN. Okay, if at any point you are unable to remember your PIN code, or you're unable to retrieve it from anywhere or anything like that, you can then reset that. So if we go back to our logging in, on our logging in, if we just go click on our screen again, our user again, and then we say forgot PIN, what it will do is it'll ask us to reset the PIN. But to do this, we're going to have to re-authenticate again, because when you set a PIN for a user, when you set that as an option, it you have to build it. So when you first log in, it'll ask you to create a PIN. When you create that PIN, then that is tied to that browser. The PIN doesn't follow you, as far as I'm aware. So we can confirm the reset, but I'd have to log back in. I'd have to go through the SAML authentication again, or we don't reset the PIN. In this case, we're going to say we don't reset the PIN. And then we're in, and we're able to do what we want to do. So likewise, there's multiple things you can set as well. So one of the big things that you'd probably want to remove would be the developer tools. So if we come down here, we can see the developer tools at the bottom. If we go back to our rule base and we edit it, and we look at our security controls, and we look at developer tools, we're going to block that. Block password saving. We can block auto-filling of forms and auto-filling of credit cards. Key login protection, I'd always put on anyway, so you can't have any key loggers or it's looking for key login. We control the pop-ups in the browser. Then we have certain network protection. So we have page with SSL errors, DNS over HTTPS. Remember that DNS over HTTPS, it's difficult to see that DNS request, so it's difficult to enforce any kind of DNS security. Trusted certificate authorities, where you can select your trusted certificate authority. So either is it the device trust store, so is it the laptop or device that I'm running on, or is it the Prisma Access browser trust store? So this can cause problems and has caused problems with things like Firefox that maintain their own trust store, specifically with SSL decryption and things like that. You'll download the certificate, you'll download the trusted root certificate, or it'll be pushed out by Intune or AD or whatever the system is within your environment, and it'll add it to the machine store, but the browser will still provide an error because it's not in the browser store and that's the one it's using. So you can select either. You can add additional trusted certificate authorities, there as well. So you can add in your own certificates. Again, basic authentication over HTTP. I would suggest to block that. We block that because any authentication over plain HTTP shouldn't be done. Anybody can see a username and password, and it's very easy to grab. Pages with insecure content. So this is so basically a HTTPS website that then brings in content from something over HTTP, which might have a form in it or might have something else in it. We're going to block that as well. False HTTPS. So false HTTPS instead of HTTP. So if we go to HTTP site, it will try and false HTTPS, and if that doesn't exist, then it will block it. And then we need extensions, so we can control over extensions. So you're getting the idea. So we've blocked our developer tools, which if we look in here, we've got developer tools blocked. And then we'll go back to our browser when it's had a chance to refresh. And now if we go up to our standard sort of three dots menu, which is our just our browser menu, and we go to more tools and come down to developer tools. So the developer tools option is blocked, and so we can't use developer tools. So that gives you the idea of the browser security in its most base and simplest form.